All right, grab your Bibles and turn it to 2 Chronicles chapter 20. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And I want to start reading at verse 1. I'll do a little different than I've done the other services. I got time. This is the service that tells me to take my time. I like y'all. Amen. 2 Chronicles chapter 20 verse 1 says, "It happened after this that the people of Moab with the people of Ammon and others with them beside the Ammonites came to battle against Jehoshaphat. Then some came and told Jehoshaphat, saying, 'A great multitude is coming against you from beyond the sea from Syria, and they are in Hazazon Tamar, which is in Gedi.' And Jehoshaphat feared and set himself to seek the Lord and proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. So Judah gathered together to ask help from the Lord and from all the cities of Judah that came to seek the Lord. Then Jehoshaphat stood in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court and said, 'Lord, O Lord God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven, and do you not rule over all the kingdoms of the nations? And in your hand is there not power and might so that no one is able to withstand you? Are you not our God who drove out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and gave it to the descendants of Abraham, your friend forever? And they dwell in it and have built you a sanctuary in it for your name, saying, if disaster comes upon us, sword, judgment, pestilence, or famine, we will stand before this temple and in your presence, for your name is in this temple, and cry out to you in our afflictions, and you will hear and save. And now here are the people of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, whom you would not let Israel invade when they came out of the land of Egypt, but they turned from them and did not destroy them. Here they are, rewarding us by coming to throw us out of your possession, which you have given us to inherit. O our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power against this great multitude that is coming against us, nor do we know what to do. But our eyes are upon you." Amen. I want to talk about a pattern for prayer that produces power. Say that back at me. Look at your neighbor. Say, the Pastor Jenkins is going to preach and present to you a powerful presentation about a pattern for prayer that produces power. Y'all got it? You can be seated. I want to dialogue with you. It's 12:58. I want to dialogue with you for the next 2 hours about prayer. Y'all are such liars. Perpetrators. I want to talk about prayer because prayer is an important component and it is essential to life. If you want to become everything God wants you to become, you want to see God's hand move in your life, you got to be a person of prayer. The unfortunate thing is that too many of us only pray when we find ourselves in trouble. Amen, Pastor. Amen. I see right now I'm going to have to encourage myself while I'm preaching. I want to talk about prayer because I listen to people pray and I discovered that people pray how they want to pray. They ignore the fact that God gives us throughout scriptures patterns to pray. Matter of fact, the Bible is filled from Genesis to Revelations with God giving us models of prayer. The disciples one time when they were meeting with Jesus said, they saw him doing all the miracles that he was doing and saw him doing what he did. And they said to him, "Teach us to pray." It would behoove us to not just come to God however we want. I know that's some of y'all's theology, that the good Lord don't care how you come to him. I know that's what you think. But the Bible is clear that the Bible is full of stories and examples that are written for our example. The Bible says these things are written for your example to show you how to do it. And in the scriptures, in the Bible, there are patterns of prayer to teach us how to pray. You just can't come to God any kind of way, pray in any kind of manner. There's a pattern of prayer. And in this particular passage of 2 Chronicles chapter 20, there's a prayer that produced a powerful result. Now let me set the stage for you so you can hear what it is that Jehoshaphat finds himself in. Then I'm going to take you and show you the results of his prayer. And then I'm going to show you what he prayed. Now he's in a situation, we read these first three verses, where the Moabites and the Ammonites and the people from Mount Seir have gathered together and combined their armies to come and attack King Jehoshaphat and the people of Judah. Now the people of Judah is the tribe of Judah. By the way, the word Judah means praise. You need to understand that when you begin to praise God, the devil's coming after you. Y'all need to get that in your heart. Don't be surprised. Don't be shocked because all of a sudden people start talking about you because you're praising God, because you're giving him thanks, because you testify about him. The devil doesn't like it when you give God glory. He won't bother you. He won't disturb anything as long as you keep silent, as long as you give him credit, as long as you don't boast about what God is doing. But the moment you decide to be a person of praise, the devil's going to try to disrupt your life. You might as well look forward to it. So this people of Judah, these people of praise are celebrating God. Judah, in fact, slow down, Pastor. Jehoshaphat becomes king of Judah at the age of 35. He's going to reign for 25 years. And he finds himself in a situation where these three nations have hooked together and they're coming to attack Judah. So he gets scared. Matter of fact, that's what verse 3 says, that he feared and he set himself to seek the Lord and proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. He got afraid because here these three kingdoms are coming against him. It is shortly thereafter that he prays. And when he finishes praying, slide down in your scriptures to verse 22 of chapter 20. I want to read starting at verse 22. Are y'all with me? When they began to sing and to praise, the Lord set ambushes against the people of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, who had come against Judah, and they were defeated. Y'all missed a great spot to shout right there. Let me see if I can put that in today's terminology. For the people who had planned to hurt Judah ended up hurting themselves. Y'all miss. Matter of fact, it said the Lord had set up an ambush against them. Verse 23, for the people of Ammon and Moab stood up against the inhabitants of Mount Seir to utterly kill and destroy them. Look at that. So here these three nations, the Ammonites, the Moabs, the Moabites, and the Mount Seirs, those from Mount Seir, had decided to come against Judah, but instead they got defeated. And look at how they got defeated. For the people of Ammon and Moab stood up against the inhabitants to utterly kill and destroy them. And when they had made an end of the inhabitants of Seir, they helped to destroy one another. Let me put the picture to you. Let me help you understand. They ended up attacking each other. And they attacked each other until everybody was dead. Now, what is the significance of that to you today? Because there are people who have plotted you getting fired, trying to get you hurt, trying to get you ashamed, trying to hurt you. But we serve a God that has the power that instead of you getting fired, they gonna get fired. Come on, look at your neighbor and say, they trying to hurt me, but they can't do me no harm. They going to get hurt themselves. I wish I had a praying crowd with me somewhere in the camp. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, they tried to hurt me, but they going to hurt themselves. Matter of fact, it was so powerful that verse 24 says, so when Judah came to a place overlooking the wilderness, they looked toward the multitudes, and there were their dead bodies falling on the earth. No one had escaped. When Jehoshaphat and his people came to take away their spoil, they found among them an abundance of valuables on the dead bodies and precious jewelry which they stripped off for themselves more than they could carry away, and they were 3 days gathering the spoil because there was so much. Y'all better be careful messing with the child of God. You might lose everything that you have messing with me. Don't try to hurt me. You might lose everything you have messing with me. Tell your neighbor, don't mess with me. Don't talk about me. Don't try to get me fired. Don't try to hurt me. I'm trying to tell somebody, you're all scared because of what they saying. You're afraid because of what they say they're going to do. Can't nobody hurt or harm you. It's an incredible testimony. They destroyed themselves, and Judah had gathered the spoils. Matter of fact, they got so much stuff, it took them 3 days to gather it. It's going to take you a few days to get what's going to be left for you. Oh, I wish I had a praying crowd with me somewhere around here. That's a powerful result. That's powerful. The people who planned to come and hurt them instead ended up killing themselves. Matter of fact, hold up. Slide over to verse 14. Jehoshaphat's prayer was so powerful that this is what God said. Look at verse 14. Then the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jehaziel, the son of Zechariah, the son of Benaiah, the son of Jael, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite of the sons of Asaph in the midst of the assembly. Y'all see that in verse 14. Here's what you need to get from all of that. That the Spirit of the Lord came upon a young man in verse 15, and he said, now this guy stood up in the midst of everybody, and God led him to say this in verse 15. Listen, all you of Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem, and you, King Jehoshaphat, thus says the Lord to you, do not be afraid nor dismayed because of this multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Oh, I wish I had somebody that got a hold of that. I don't know who this is for, but God told me to drop this down in somebody's spirit. You all stressed out, all worried, all afraid, don't know which way to turn, don't know what to do. But God told me to tell you, the battle is not yours, but it's the Lord's. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, somebody look at your neighbor and say, they running in the streets. They running in the aisles. I'm trying to help somebody get it in your heart. Don't be afraid. Don't be fearful. The battle is not yours. It's God. He's already got it under control. He's already mapped it out. He's already determined what's going to happen to the people who are trying to hurt you. He's got it under control. Come on, high five somebody and say, the battle is not yours. Tell them on the other side, you all tripping out, you all nervous, you all scared, you got all kind of anxiety. It's not your battle. It's not for you to worry about. You ain't gonna have to lift a finger. You ain't gonna have to call nobody. You're not gonna have to file no suit. You're not gonna have to piss nobody off. You ain't gonna have to cuff nobody out. The battle is not yours. It's the Lord's battle. Somebody ought to already give him a shout right there and say, God's got my back. God got me under control. He's looking out for me. He got the situation in his hands. Somebody's getting freed right now. Somebody, the burden is being lifted. Somebody's got a shout down in your soul. Somebody, the devil tried to take you out. Your blood pressure just got lowered. Your pressure just got relieved because you've been all stressed out. But here is the word of the Lord to you. The battle is not yours. Now, let me show you how he prayed that produced that kind of result. My goal today is to show you how to pray that will cause your enemies to kill themselves. I'm telling y'all, by this time next week, your enemy will be destroyed. I prophesy that to you. By this time next week, you're going to come skipping in church today. You came in here with your head down. You're going to walk out of here with it lifted up. And by the time you come in here next week, your battle will have been won. Your enemies will have been defeated. And you're going to come in here skipping and dancing and shouting and celebrating. The battle is not yours. So he prayed. In verse 3, he was afraid and he set himself to seek the Lord. Verse 4, he gathered together to ask help from the Lord, and from all the cities of Judah, they came to seek the Lord. Then Jehoshaphat, verse 5, stood in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court and said, are y'all with me? Now he begins to pray. There's four parts to his prayer. I'm trying to get you to remember these four parts. Here's number one. The first part of his prayer is he recognized God's hand. Verse 6, look at it. Think about this. Look at it. O Lord God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven? And do you not rule over all the kingdoms of the nations? And in your hand is there not power and might, so that no one is able to withstand you? Y'all missed a great place to shout. Because a part of going to prayer is you recognizing that there's somebody who's got your back. And Jehoshaphat went in prayer with the mentality of saying, this is God. God has the power. God has a hand. There's no weapon formed against you that can prosper. There's no power that can defend you. I like his prayer because he's praying to God, say, you the man. And all power is in your hand. I like this prayer. He just simply say, God, aren't you the God in heaven? See, when you go to God, you have to keep in mind who you are talking to. Oh, I wish I had a praying crowd with me. Here's the deal. Some of y'all done look to everybody else for help. And the bank can't help you. Your cousin can't help you. Your parents can't help you. Your job can't help you. Capitol Hill can't help you. And there are certain times, I believe, God puts you in a situation where nobody else can deliver you or help you, so that when he does deliver you, nobody gets the credit but God. And I think there's somebody in here who knows that they have been in a situation and you saw the thing worked out, and you know that nobody could have worked it out but God and God alone. Do I have a witness anywhere in the camp? Nobody but God, nobody but God, but God, but God, but God. He says, I recognize it's his hand that woke you up this morning. It's his hand that brought you thus far in your life. It's his hand. It's his hand. Somebody say, it's his hand. When you go to God, start off recognizing it's his power. Don't go to God starting off talking about what people did to you, giving them all the credit, and they did this and they did. Shut up. It ain't about them. They can't stop God doing for you what he wants to do for you. I'm sick of hearing people praying, giving the devil credit and the people credit who's giving you the blues. Shut up. They ain't your God. Let's talk about the God. Let's start off talking about the God who... Here's point two. It's in verse 7. Point two is, not only did he recognize God's hand, but he remembered God's history. Somebody say, remember God's history. This is verse 7. Are you not our God who drove out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and gave it to the descendants of Abraham, your friend forever? I love that right there. Because here's what he said. God, here's what he's doing. He's reminding himself that he has seen the history of what our God has done. Here's what some of y'all need. You need to stop thinking about the drama of your present and remember his power from your past. I wish I had a praying crowd. I wish y'all wouldn't look at me like I'm speaking to you in a foreign language. I don't know your history. I don't know all the details of your life. But here's what I do know, is that everybody in this building has had something happen in your life that you can look back on and point the finger and know that nobody but God himself could have brought me out of that situation. Nobody but God could have done that thing. Only God could have healed that situation. Oh, there y'all go acting like. Okay, I know. That's right. This is the 12 o'clock crowd. See, at 8 o'clock, at this point in the service, everybody was standing because they had a testimony of what was in their past. But the 12 o'clock crowd, I know why y'all not standing, because y'all have a testimony, but and it's so tremendous, but you got caught in a situation that you shouldn't have been in, and you haven't been able to testify about what God brought you out of, because you weren't supposed to be there in the first place. Hey! But I ain't gonna ask you what he brought you out of. I ain't gonna tell you to testify. Keep it to yourself, but just testify to the fact that I've got a history with God. I've seen him open doors. I've seen him do miracles. I've seen him answer my prayer. I got a history with God. I cried out to him in the past, and he brought me out of the muck and miry clay. He healed me when I was sick. He straightened my marriage out. He delivered my children. He gave me money when I needed right in the negative. Somebody say, I got history. Thank God for the doors that he's opened. Tell him I'm thankful for the doors that he opened. Tell him on the side, I got some doors I'm thankful that he opened. Somebody need to say, I thank God there's some doors. I'm thankful for some doors he kept closed. Somebody better thank God for the people you didn't marry. Come on, say, thank God for the people I didn't get hooked up with. Thank God for the job that I didn't get, because that company went out of business now. Thank God I've got history with him. Think about it. That's what you got to do when you go to prayer. Keep reminding yourself. A lot of this is to build up your faith. Recognizing his hand and remembering his history is to build up your faith, because he that comes to God must first believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. I can't get no help up in here from anybody. I'm just trying to get you to understand that we got a God who has the power and the ability to step into your situation, and you've got the past to recall. And guess what? I've learned to thank God for what he's doing right now, and I've also learned to thank God for what he's going to do in my tomorrows. I ain't got there yet, don't know what it's going to be, but his credit is good with me. I'm making payments in my praise on stuff he gonna do next week, next month, next year. I don't know what it is, but I know he's got my best interest at heart. Somebody help me praise God for your tomorrow. Somebody help me thank God for your today. Somebody help me praise him for what he did in your yesterdays. Hey. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. Your praise ain't based on what's happening now. You got a history from your past. Praise him for the past and know that he's working on your right now, right there. You might not see it. It may not be visible to you, but he's working on it. Hallelujah. I like this 12 o'clock service. I can just stay right here for as long as I want to. I want to praise him. I want to thank him. I want to give him praise. Not for y'all. I'm praising him for my own life and what he's done in my own life. The miracles he's wrought in my own life. The doors he's opened in my own life. The doors he closed in my own life. Thank you, Jesus. I'm not ashamed. I'm not ashamed to glorify him. Y'all might as well go ahead and give him a praise. I'm taking my time here today. Hallelujah. You just might as well go ahead and praise him. Think about it. Think about it. Give him some praise for last year. Give him some praise for last week. Give him some praise 5 years ago when he did something for you. Give him some praise. Come to him and remind yourself he has fixed it before. He has solved it before. He's done miracles before. He has not being God. He is still the same God today as he was 1,000 years ago, 100 years ago, 5 years ago. He's still the same God. Hallelujah. That's rich right there. I feel an anointing right there. I feel miracles happening for people right here. If you would just take the time to worship him and praise him. And I know you're cute and arrogant and you don't want to mess up your do and you get your mascara messed up. I know you don't want your wig to fall off. I know you don't want people looking at you, but forget about them. Matter of fact, tell yourself, I didn't get as dignified last week as I'm about to get dignified this week. You thought I was crazy last week? Wait till I stop praising him this week. I'm going to give him an undignified dance and an undignified praise. We bind that spirit of fear. We rebuke fear. We rebuke the scaredness that the devil is trying to put in your heart. Let me put this word in your heart that there's a God who is God, who you have a history with, and he did not bring through all your trouble that he brought you through to abandon you now. He is still with you. Somebody say, yeah. Glory, glory, glory to Jesus. Bless his holy and righteous name. Amen. I know you don't feel like it, but he's worthy of our praise. I know the devil done sapped your joy, but God is about to restore your joy. Hallelujah. You are about to enter into a place where your enemies are going to kill themselves, when there's going to be more plunder left over, more spoil left over than you imagine. You're about to see some stuff drop in your account, drop in your life that is beyond what you ever dreamed or imagined. Thank you.
About this time next week is a breakthrough. About this time next week, you're gonna walk in with a leap and a joy and a dance. About this time next week.
The battle is not yours. 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 You won't have to lift a finger. You won't have to do a thing. The battle is not yours, but it's God's. Hey! Hallelujah. Feel something in here. I feel the presence of God. I feel the glory of God. I feel an anointing of God. I feel the glory of God. You might as well reach up and grab a hold of His glory. Tell Him thank you. Tell Him I receive it, God. Hallelujah. I don't know who this is for, but I'm prophesying to you right now. It's not your battle. It's not your fight. I didn't get through the rest of this sermon. I'm gonna have to give it to you another day. But let's just pause right here where the Spirit of God is doing something. Don't walk out of here with that yoke that you came in here with. Don't walk out of here with that fear that you came in here with. What I like about this situation is they came with fear. But by the time they go out, let me find this verse. Verse 19 says, then the Levites of the children of the Kohathites and the children of the Korahites stood up to praise the Lord God of Israel with voices loud and high. They started in fear. They left with a praise. That's what's happening right here. You came in here with fear about your circumstance, but you're leaving out of here with a loud and high voice of praise. Go ahead and lift your hands and open your mouth and tell Him thank you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. He is a God whose everything is in His hand. He gave you the job in the first place. They can't fire you. He gave you the job. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Almighty God. It's you, Jesus. It's you. We give you the glory, Lord Jesus. Your name is worthy of the praise, Almighty God. It's your hand that brought us this far. You didn't bring us here to abandon us and leave us. Thank you, God. It's your hand that we see and recognize.
Hallelujah. Yeah.
It is his hand. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah.
This is not a time to watch. It's a time to participate. Time to go ahead and give him praise and thanks for what he's done for you. To worship him, worship him, worship him. Tell him he's worthy, tell him he's worthy. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Now listen to me. Listen to me. Let me give you the last 2 points. I'm just going to give them to you. I'm not going to have time to preach them. But the third point is that you got to realize that God hears. The devil tries to tell y'all that God don't hear you. The devil wants you to think you have to dot every I and cross every T. We do not go to God in prayer on the basis of our righteousness. Jehoshaphat said in his prayer, God, I know you hear. I know you hear. You got to go to God knowing that he hears. He will incline his ear to your situation. Amen. I don't care what you're facing. We can go boldly to the throne of grace. With the confidence that he hears. He may not answer as quickly as you want, but when he does answer, it'll be right on time. Tell your neighbor, he hears, he hears, he hears. I need you to realize that he hears. And finally, the fourth point is he reflected humility, God's humility. Jehoshaphat went with humility. He said, I don't know what to do. You can't go to God arrogantly. You have to go humbly to God. Humility moves God. Some of you need to come to God with humility. You need to humble yourself. Bring yourself down to this altar. Just kneel down here. Say, you know what, God? I need to humble myself before you. I got a situation that's beyond my ability to control or change, but I know you can. Come on and kneel down here. We're going to pray. We're going to make this a prayer meeting for just a couple more minutes. Amen. We could be all going home. I told y'all the next 2 hours. Y'all said amen. It's prayer time. That's what we're going to do. I mean, you got a tough situation.
Yes.
You got an impossible situation. You got a situation that you don't know a human being that can change it or help it. You need God to step in and change somebody's heart. You need God to come in and provide some resources. You need the Almighty God. The world is in his hands. We're going to humble ourselves before him. Go ahead, start talking to him. I gave you the order already. Recognize his hand. Remember his history. Realize that he hears.
Yes, Lord.
Reflect godly humility. You're an awesome God, Lord. And it has been your hand that brought us thus far in our journey. And we thank you. It's your hand that has fought the battles. It is your hand that has opened the doors. And Father, we take a moment to praise and thank you for what you have done in our lives. Thank you for when you healed us when we were sick. You delivered us when we were bound. You saved us when we were lost. We remember from where you have brought us from. Thank you. We remember, God. We have not forgotten the awesomeness of who you are. Thank you. We remember when. Thank you. Father, I thank you that your sons and daughters are gathered all around this place, all on their knees, some standing, some tears running down their faces. God, I know you're the God that hears their cries. I know that you know their circumstances. Thank you for leaning in this direction. We humble ourselves before you today and declare that we don't know what to do. We don't know where to go. But Father, just like Jehoshaphat, we are anticipating that you are going to fight the battles. We're believing that the battle is not ours anymore. We take our hands off of it and we put it in your hands. It's yours now, God. It's yours. We surrender it to you, God. Forgive us for thinking that we could fix it. We repent today. We repent, Father. And we lay it at your feet. We cast all of our cares upon you. Now, God, we anticipate and we believe that those who seek our harm will themselves be defeated. And we believe tonight, today, this afternoon, we believe that you will give us plunder more than we ever imagined we would have. Somebody here today, God, you're going to give them enough money to pay and catch up that mortgage in Jesus' name. Somebody's going to get enough money somehow, some way that you worked it out, Father. to get the treatments that they need. Somebody's going to get healed in Jesus' name by your awesome hand and power. And we thank you. Whatever the situation, we believe is working out. Whatever it is, God, we believe you're fixing it. You're changing hearts. You're fixing marriages. You're delivering children. You're bringing people out of addiction. God, we receive it in Jesus' name. And we give you the praise, the glory, and the thanks. Hallelujah. Amen. Come on, let's give him some praise all over this place. It's a done deal. It's a done deal. Hallelujah. It's a done deal, baby. Don't take this fear back to your seats with you. Don't take the anxiety of uncertainty. Please don't carry it back to your seat with you. Leave it right here. Amen. Take your hands off. It's done. It's done. It's done. Amen. It's done. It's done. It's done. Glory, glory. Just go on back telling him thank you as you go back. Just tell him praise his name as you go back. Give him glory as you go back. Now, if you need to get saved, come on down here right now. You need to get saved. You know you ain't right with God. You feel distant and disconnected from what's going on. You know that if you died today, you wouldn't be in heaven. You'd go straight to hell. Come on and get saved today. Maybe you're backslidden. You drifted away from God. You're not walking with him like you used to. You want to be restored. Come on down quickly, right now, right now. Come and say, you know what? I need to rededicate myself to the Lord Jesus. Come on right now. Come on right now. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, man. I got you. You need a church home? Come on down here. You need a church home right now. Come on, right now. You already saved, walking with God, but you need a church home. I'm proud of you. Come on. I'm proud of you, baby. I'm so proud of you, sweetheart. Hey, man. Buddy. Praise the Lord. Wonderful. God bless you, baby. Hey. So proud of you, sweetheart. Step right there. So proud of you, young man. Come on. Amen. Praise the Lord. So proud of you, man. There's some others here. Let me just wait a moment or two. There's some others. Come on. Don't let the enemy hold you in your seat. Let me tell you something. The decision to get saved, rededicate, get assurance, or even join church, you don't wait till your spouse says amen to it. This is between you and God. If they want to stay out there and not want to be committed, and you know God's calling you to make the decision today, make it right now. And I know you're out there. Just come on. I know there's a voice on one side telling you one thing, but I know there's another voice that's the Spirit of God telling you to go forward. Please don't let the enemy keep you from making the choice when God is calling you to make the choice. So proud of you.